That was interesting. I turned off webcam and it told me I had to enable webcam to talk. Hello, Violinist. Well, Happy New Year, Treasure. Joanne, I, Crosswalk, and Violinist. I guess my mic is working. So welcome to the last Monday night of this month, this year, and even this decade. Think about it. I am Shalom Debbie. The song we're going to listen to tonight is, it's a fairly new one by Matthew West, and it's called The God Who Stays. No matter what is going on, God will be with us. So we're going to listen to this together as soon as I put it in the player. And if you will type done when you're finished. Yeah, the new Roaring Twenties.
If I were you, I would have given up on me by now. I would have labeled me a lost cause, 'cause I feel just like a lost cause. If I were you, I would have turned around and walked away. I would have labeled me beyond prepared, 'cause I feel like I'm beyond prepared. Oh, but somehow you don't see me like I do. Somehow you're still. You're the God who stays. You're the God who stays. You're the one who runs in my direction. When the whole world walks away, you're the God who stands with wide open arms. And you tell me nothing I have ever done. My heart from the God who stays.
Okay, and treasure's probably done. We're gonna pray now, but we're gonna do it a little differently tonight. For our prayer, I want to share one that Billy Graham prayed back in 2008 as that year came to a close. Someone shared it with me today, and I quite liked it, so I thought, well, I'll bring that tonight. So this prayer is from Billy Graham. It was written for the Saturday Evening Post in 2008, and it's just as relevant and even more so than it was then. So he said, "Our Father and our God, as we stand at the beginning of a new year, we confess our need of your presence and your guidance as we face the future. We each have our hopes and expectations for the year that is ahead of us, but you alone, God, know what it holds for us, and only you can give us the strength and the wisdom we will need to meet its challenges. So, Lord, help us to humbly put our hand into your hand and to trust you and to seek your will for our lives during this coming year. Father God, in the midst of life's uncertainties and in the days ahead, assure us of the certainty of your unchanging love. In the midst of life's inevitable disappointments and heartaches, help us to turn to you for the stability and comfort we will need. And in the midst of life's temptations and the pull of our stubborn self-will, help us not to lose our way, but to have courage to do what is right in your sight, regardless of the cost. And Father, in the midst of our daily preoccupation and pursuits, open our eyes to the sorrows and injustice of our hurting world, and help us to respond with compassion and sacrifice to those who are friendless and in need. May our constant prayer be that of the ancient psalmist who said, "Teach me, teach us, O Lord, to follow your decrees, and then we will keep them to the end." And that's a quote from Psalm 119:33. We also pray for our nation, our nations, and our leaders during these difficult times. And we pray for all those who are seeking to bring peace and justice to our dangerous and troubled world.
And Father, we pray especially, we ask for your protection on all those who served in our armed forces and in our police departments and fire departments and our medical emergency workers. And we thank you for their commitment to defend our freedom, even at the cost of their own lives. Be with their families also and assure them of your love and concern for them. Father, we ask you to bring our divided nation together and give us a greater vision of what you would have us to be. Because your word reminds us that blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, Psalm 33:12. And as we look back over this past year, we thank you for your goodness to us, far beyond what we have deserved. May we never presume on your past goodness or forget all your mercies to us, but may they instead lead us to repentance and to a new commitment to make you the foundation and center of our lives this year. And so, Father, as we gather here tonight, we thank you for the promise and hope of this new year and this new decade, and we look forward to it with expectancy and faith. And we ask this in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who by his death and resurrection has given us hope both for this world and the world to come. Amen. Now, wasn't that nice and so appropriate? So last week, on Tuesday, I think it was Tuesday, anyhow, Christmas Eve, at our church, we read from John 1. And John 1 is one of my favorite parts of the Bible. The focus for the sermon was on the phrase grace and truth. Grace and truth captured my interest. And so guess what? We're going to pursue that together tonight. So what we're going to do is we're going to read, and I'll sometimes comment, John 1. Not First John, but John, the Gospel of John, chapter 1. And we're going to watch for grace and truth. It's going to pop up in there twice. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made which was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Me too. Dodie note. And I just said he loves it. I just love this passage. Many years ago, I memorized parts of it, and it just touches my heart so much still. Think about it. In the beginning. That means at creation, when God spoke and the world began. And notice also the capital W, when it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. This is the Trinity, present and all-inclusive from the very beginning. The Word is Jesus. And the Word, Jesus, was with God, Elohim, and the Word was God. You see it? Genesis 1:1, Viola said at the Adult Bible Fellowship that me and my mom attended church after the service each week. We're studying John there too as well. Oh, cool. Genesis 1:1 says, In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And that word God is Elohim, which is plural. Verse 3 says, and back to John 1 verse 3 says, all things were made through him, and without him was not anything made which was made. Him who? Jesus, the living word, Elohim, the triune Godhead. Yes, it's singular when you say El Shaddai, but Elohim is different from what I've read. So continuing with verse 6, and remember, we are watching for grace and truth. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to bear witness about the light that all men might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness about the light. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. And did we not just celebrate that on Christmas? But this is speaking of John the Baptist. And verse 10 goes on to say, he, and now we're talking about Jesus, was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came unto his own, and his own people did not receive him. But, verse 12, but to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but born of God. Doty note. Jesus came first for the Jewish people, his own. But they, or many of them, not all of them, rejected him. But those who did not reject him became the true children of God, who were born anew, or born again, of God. And isn't it grand that we are included in those children of God? I do not know. Somebody can look it up. I could look it up. Because when Mary traveled to see Elizabeth, so we know that he didn't live in the Bethlehem, Jerusalem area. He lived somewhere else, but I don't know, northern or southern. And here we go, verse 14. And the Word, Jesus, the living Word, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory. Glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. And I said, the Father was the thought of creation. Jesus was the Word that spoke the creation. And the Holy Spirit made it happen. Yeah, because the Spirit hovered over the earth. And the Father spoke. Do you see it? There it is. When Jesus was born, he was full of both grace and truth. Continuing in John 1. Because remember I said, yeah, they're one. All three is one. With different functions. John bore witness about him and cried out, this was he of whom I said, He who comes after me ranks before me because he was before me. Verse 16, for from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. And Dodi note, when I read that, and I'm thinking while I'm reading or typing, you know, from his fullness, reminded me of the verse that says, in the fullness of time, meaning just right, perfect time. It's in Ephesians 1, and it says, the text reads, blessed be God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, with which he has blessed us in the beloved. 7-10. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to unite all things in him, in heaven and on earth. And isn't it kind of neat how in a way these two passages go together? These two passages written by two different people, but both of them inspired by the Holy Spirit, say close to the same thing. Jesus, who was full of grace and truth, came in the fullness of time at just the right ordained by God time in order that we might become children of God. And Crosswalk said this chapter explains the Trinity if you truly understand it. It does. All three of these, Genesis and John and what are we just reading from Ephesians? And I've lost my place. And John 1, we're going back to John 1 now to finish it up. It continues. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, the only God who is at the Father's side. He has made him known. Do you see it repeated here? Grace and truth through Jesus. And grace and truth are kind of interesting to consider, because they're deceived. Violinist asks, how can Jehovah's Witness say there is no basis for the Trinity when it plainly shows it here? And I said, because they're deceived. So grace and truth are interesting to consider, and they seem opposites in a way. Colossians 1, 5-7 speaks of grace and truth also. It says, because of the hope laid up for you in heaven, of this you have heard before in the word of the truth, the gospel, which has come to you, as indeed in the whole world it is bearing fruit and increasing, as it also does among you, since the day you heard it and understood the grace of God in truth. Just as you learned it from Epaphras, our beloved brother servant, he is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf. I'm not saying his name right, and I know how to say it, but right now I can't. And again, grace and truth are linked together in 2 John 2-4. Because of the truth that abides in us and will be with us forever, which is Jesus, also known as the Holy Spirit, grace, mercy, and peace will be with us from God the Father and from Jesus Christ, the Father's Son, in truth and love. I rejoiced greatly to find some of your children walking in the truth, just as we were commanded by the Father. So, getting it. Truth says we are sinners, and we deserve death for our sin. But Jesus, who is both truth and grace, says, yes, you do deserve death, but I come and take that penalty for or from you because I am grace. Yeah, I love those long statements. So truth condemns, but grace covers, and both are found in Jesus. And we're going to read 2 John now in the English Standard. Everything is ESV, unless I say differently. Greetings. The elder to the elect lady and her children, whom I love in truth, and not only I, but also all who know the truth, because of the truth that abides in us and will be with us forever. Do you think that the truth that abides in us and will be with us forever is the actual person of Jesus in the form of the Holy Spirit? And I said, show them the verse. And verse 3 says of John, 2 John, grace, mercy, and peace will be with us from God the Father and from Jesus Christ the Father's Son in truth and love. Grace, mercy, peace, truth, love. And John goes on to say, I rejoiced greatly to find some of your children walking in the truth, just as we were commanded by the Father. And now, dear lady, that he's writing to, I ask you, dear lady, not as though I were writing you a new commandment, but the one we've had from the beginning, that we love one another. And my dirty note says, yep, people annoy us. People can get on our last nerve. People sin against us. They hurt us. And that is the truth. But we also do that to God, don't we? We probably don't get on his last nerve or annoy him, but we hurt him with our disobedience. And what does God do? What did he do? And what does he do? He sent Jesus, full of grace and truth, and he forgives us. And so, yes, he loves us anyway. And do you think we are called to do likewise? When we're hurt, when someone sins against us, we are not called to deny our hurt, but we are called to let it go and apply graceful forgiveness. And verse 6 of 2 John says, and this is love, that we walk according to his commandments. This is the commandment, just as you have heard from the beginning, that you should walk in it. And I want you to notice something. Love is an action. Love means to obey. He said, this is love, that we walk according to his commandments. Obey. Love is not just a feeling or just when we feel like being nice. Love is a command, first to love God by obeying his word and then to love others. Forgiving. And loving others by no means excuses their actions towards us. And it does not, forgiving does not exclude having boundaries for our safety. But it does mean letting them go into God's care and refusing to badmouth or try to get even in any sort of way. Sometimes, if we're the one who's hurt someone or wounded someone else, repentance requires us to accept and respect their boundaries also when we are the one who has wounded another. And then changing tracks and back to 2 John, for many deceivers have gone out into the world. This would be the Jehovah's Witness, who do not confess the coming of Jesus Christ in the flesh. Such a one is the deceiver and the antichrist. So he says, yeah, many others, watch yourselves so that you may not lose what we have worked for and gain a full reward. Everyone, verse 9, everyone who goes on ahead and does not abide in the teaching of Christ does not have God. Whoever abides in the teaching has both the Father and the Son. So, Dodie note. Do we see that we need to abide, to continue to learn, to continue to rest in and on Jesus' completed work on the cross, and to obey? But, and this is my personal opinion, we are also to judge. Yes, judge. But we judge if teachings or people who bring teachings are following God as set forth in the Bible. We do not follow any false teaching, however cool it seems. It might be fun and it might be cool, but we need to run away. Because verse 10 says, if anyone comes to you and does not bring this teaching, do not receive him into your house or give him any greeting, for whoever greets him takes part his good works. So my comment is, I think that means we have to be careful who we keep company with and where we go and what we do. And now I'm going to quote an author who's quite interesting, Randy Alcorn. He has some great books out there. He says, grace and truth found their perfect union in Christ. But the rest of us tend to gravitate towards either one or the other. Truth. Without grace breeds self-righteousness and legalism. We all know people like that. We could be inclined that way ourselves. But grace without truth breeds deception and moral compromise. We see that too. Randy A. Alcorn says, the key to true Christian spirituality is to integrate grace and truth, these two qualities, into life, imitating the character of Christ, who, according to John, the Gospel of John, was full of grace and truth. And Randy says, our ability to be gracious flows from recognizing how much God has done for us and how little we deserve it. So truth, in a good way, acts upon us, helping us to see reality according to God's perspective. But as we learn to apply the truth in a gracious manner and to be gracious within the bounds of truth, we will indeed reflect Christ to a world clamoring for authenticity. They want to see authentic Christians. And maybe next week, but I'm not sure yet, we will delve into abiding. I don't know. But for tonight, one week or almost 1 week after Christmas and right before the new year, let's cling to grateful hearts that Jesus was born, and because he was, we can become children of God. And also that Jesus is both grace and truth, and he was born to bring both. So, Father God, thank you for sending Jesus. Thank you for truth so that we can know right from wrong and make informed choices. But also, thank you for grace when we mess up. Be with us all until we meet again. In Jesus' name, amen. And I actually have a closing song, which is a prayer. It's called Keep Me in Your Will. I like it a lot. You know this song, Violinist? I figured you know all the same songs I do. And thank you for coming. After I put the song in the player, I'm going to shut my mic off and I'm not turning it back on. So you guys have a great and safe New Year's Eve tomorrow.
Keep me in your way. Thank you.
lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first I'll soon.